Okay. So today we'll begin from where we stopped yesterday, and that was the rise of Bengal and specifically the role of Aliwardi Khan as well as Nursheed Quli in the formation of Bengal. In the class yesterday we had talked about a couple of things. We had started with our discussion on with the decline of the Mughal Empire as well as the causes for the decline of the Mughal Empire. When we are looking into the causes for the decline of the Mughal Empire, we broadly looked into the economic causes, the political causes, some socio-religious causes, and also causes related to the structure of the army itself, and how all of these resulted in the decline of the Mughal Empire. Now, one of the consequences, as we discussed yesterday, of the decline of the centralized Mughal Empire was the rise of successor states of the Mughal Empire. One of the important successor states of the Mughal Empire that we started a discussion with was Bengal. In our discussion on Bengal, what we talked about yesterday was certain characteristics of the Bengali state and the state under Murshid Quli and later under Aliwardi Khan, which made it firstly an integral portion of when it existed of the centralized Mughal state. We had discussed that how Bengal, specifically with its focus on trade as well as important increase in agricultural productivity, contributed a significant chunk of revenue to the centralized Mughal state. And later with Murshid Quli and later with Aliwardi Khan, with the rise of the successor state, what we found was that the importance of the merchant bankers increased significantly in the court of the Bengal Nawab, to the extent that the Jagat Seth, with the coming of Aliwardi Khan, became influential bankers in the Mughal court, or in the court of the Bengali Nawab, and also became the treasurer from 1927 onwards. We had also talked about yesterday when we were discussing that first there was Murshid Quli, then Aliwardi Khan came in power in 1727, and he was there till 1756. With the death of Aliwardi Khan in 1756, we talked about how yesterday that the rise of the young Siraj-ud-Daula was a kind of a threat to the interests of Jagat Seth and other merchant bankers, who felt that they were going to be subjected to increasing control at the hands of the young Nawab. And one of the response was to enter into a collaboration with the British, and this is what resulted in the Battle of Plassey. We'll discuss in detail, but for now that much is enough. So discussing about the role of the trade, I had also told you yesterday that Bengal had both the overland trade routes as well as the sea-based trading routes. However, the overland trading routes were the ones which were subjected to multiple disruptions because of the invasions on the one side by the Afghan invaders and on the other side by the Marathas. And this made the oceanic trade or the naval trade more important in the Bengali trade structure. And with the emphasis on naval trade or oceanic trade increasing under Aliwardi Khan, the role of the European traders who often came to the sea route also became more important. So the role of the British, the role of the French, Portuguese, Dutch, all in became important in the trading regime under Aliwardi Khan, especially in the 1750s onwards. Now, so another important thing that has to be understood is that trading, when it started under the Mughal regime, and trading specifically with the East India Company, was something that was profitable to the Indian traders and Indian merchants, in the sense that before the Industrial Revolution, and we'll see this later, that before the Industrial Revolution, India was an exporter of finished goods. So we would not export cotton, but we would export finished textile goods. And the Indian traders in this whole trading business would make a significant amount of revenue and would generate a significant amount of profit, a part of which would be taxed and go as revenue to the state itself. So trade was a very lucrative activity, and in the sense that given the fact that India was exporting, and I think you would have read this, now I don't need to put much head on this, but you would have read a lot about this, the balance of trade and the structure of trade and economy, that if you're exporting finished products, you're likely to make a much greater profit than when you're exporting raw materials. Given the fact that India was a major exporter of finished products, whether it was spices, whether it was textile, or whether it was other handicraft-based products, a significant amount of profits were being generated by these traders. And this profit came to India in the form of gold, because gold was the international currency of trade at that point of time. Because before the dollar or the yen or the RMB started becoming important currencies at the world level, you would have read this in economy, right? That gold was the important system of trade. So in the sense that all these trading activities resulted in a huge accumulation of gold reserves that... resulted in a huge accumulation of gold reserves, in the sense that Bengal always enjoyed a favorable balance of trade, meaning Bengal was exporting more than it was importing, with a surplus bullion or gold being brought in by the European companies to buy Bengali goods. On the Indian side, this trade was dominated by merchants, and they enjoyed a cordial relation with the state and the bureaucracy within Bengal. So when we often talk about this proverbial saying, right, that sone ki chidiya, right? So the whole emphasis on bullion and prosperity is because of the favorable balance of trade. And I'm emphasizing this again, that India was exporting finished goods at this point of time, because later we'll see that even when India was exporting, the trade or the nature of the exports shifted when India was a British colony. The nature of exports shifted at a later period of time from finished goods to raw materials. So we'll come to it, but I want to make this point clear here as well. So if you see this much, the timeline roughly that I had already told you, that Murshid Quli was there till 1727. Then after the death of Murshid Quli, Ali Wardi Khan came to power with the help of the Jagat Seth bankers. The result was the importance of bankers and traders became visible in the Bengali Nawab's court. And it was Ali Wardi Khan, I had told you later, that while Murshid Quli himself was one of the important generals in the court of Aurangzeb when Aurangzeb was alive, after the death of Murshid Quli, all sort of even symbolic relations with the centralized Mughal empire was broken by Ali Wardi Khan. So Ali Wardi Khan started minting coins in his own name. The Friday prayers were often offered in his name specifically, rather than in the name of the centralized Mughal emperor, as had been the tradition before. So Ali Wardi Khan marked almost a total break from the past, and also very crucially, Ali Wardi Khan stopped paying any sort of revenues to the centralized Mughal ruler. So this also weakened the Mughals or the centralized Mughals rule financially from 1730s onwards. Okay, so that is also something that has to be kept in mind. Now, before I actually get into the Battle of Plassey, the causes for the Battle of Plassey, and the impact of Battle of Plassey and partition, and Battle of Plassey and Battle of Buxar, there's one more important player that obviously we will take up in greater detail later, and that is the role of the Marathas. But even before that, even here, I think it is important to emphasize the fact that the Ali Wardi Khan and the Bengali province at that point of time was facing a strong threat from the Marathas. Now, there's one thing that you need to know, that Shivaji died in, the date is not exactly important, but the Shivaji died in 1680. And up till the death of Aurangzeb, the Marathas were subdued by and large by Aurangzeb. After the death of Aurangzeb, the next major power to rise was the Marathas. And the Marathas were in many ways looking for this opportunity where they could regain at least their lost positions in Maharashtra itself. However, the weakening of the centralized Mughal rule strengthened the fortunes of none other than the Marathas in this most significant manner in this region. We will see later that whether it was the Hyderabad state or the Mysore state or the Bengal state, no one could reach a kind of a territorial position or could expand its territories to the extent after the Mughals as the Marathas did. So Marathas in many ways could have been the next pan-Indian empire, and Marathas had reached their glory by 1750s, 1760s, okay, before the Third Battle of Panipat in many ways. So by 1750s, roughly, the Marathas were almost at the highest in terms of their territorial reach. And we'll see a map also later to see what were the positions that Marathas covered or were under Maratha control during the 1750s and 60s. More or less, all of these such positions expanded from Maharashtra almost up to Bengal and almost up to Panipat in the north. Okay. So they were an important preeminent power around 1750s. The expansion of Marathas was a constant threat. When the Marathas expanded after the decline of centralized Mughal rule, the expansion of Marathas was a constant threat to everyone, to the Nizams of Hyderabad as well as to the Nawab of Bengal. Now, Bengal at that point of time under Murshid Kuli and later under Ali Wardi Khan, when we say the Bengal province, it is also something important to know that Bengal province was not only Bengal as we understand today, but the whole of West Bengal as well as Bangladesh, as well as Bihar, as well as Odisha. So it was geographically a large unit. So because obviously it was a territorially or geographically a large unit, it was in conflict at many points of times with the Maratha state. And the Marathas, who were at the peak of their military strength during the 1750s, frequently raided the territories of the Nawab of Bengal. The result of this was that Ali Wardi Khan very soon realized that he was not in a position to militarily challenge. He was not in a position to militarily challenge the Marathas, and thus he reached an effective deal with the Marathas without fighting a war or without fighting a full-blown war. And in 1751, Ali Wardi Khan reached an agreement with the Marathas, agreeing to pay Marathas chauth for Bengal and handing over Odisha to the Marathas for the whole tax collection. So what Marathas got in this deal with Ali Wardi Khan was one-fourth of the tax collections of Bengal, as we understand Bengal today, and almost the whole of revenue from Odisha. So what could be better for Marathas in a way that they got an effective deal which would strengthen them financially without having to establish a full-scale administration or carrying out a full-blown out war? So this was also symbolic of the strength of Marathas, where the descendants of the Mughal Empire were ready to offer a truce or an agreement recognizing the military superiority of the Marathas to prevent a full-scale war and reach some sort of an agreement with them. So that gives you a sense of what was happening at this point of time. Why this point is important, and I mentioned this, I'll come to later, because one of the things that we'll see after some time is the point that a number of princely states after the decline of the centralized Mughal ruler were often at war with each other. So we will see later that Mysore was a big threat to the Marathas as well as to the Hyderabad state. Marathas themselves were a big threat to the Bengali state as well as to the Hyderabad state. So after the decline of the centralized Mughal rule, if you draw a map, you find that the Marathas were here. The Hyderabad state was here. The Mysore state was here. And the Bengal state was here. So we'll see that the Marathas, as they expanded in every direction. Okay. No issues, no issues. Just everybody keep your phone on silent. That's it. At times it happens, no issues. So one of the things that was happening at this point of time, that Marathas were expanding northwards towards Bengal as well as towards Hyderabad. So Maratha was a major threat to a number of princely states in this region. At the same point of time, Mysore also was expanding, and Mysore was a threat to Hyderabad and to Marathas. Why I'm bringing this in here is because you will see later that it was these differences between the princely states that were utilized both by the French and by the English to establish alliances and to establish ruling elites who were closer to either party. And often they brought in something that we'll see later, for example, was the idea of a subsidiary alliance. So often what the English later would do when they would come become an important player is, for example, they would enter into a subsidiary alliance with, say, the Hyderabad state and offer them a military guarantee of being protected against invasions from the Marathas or against Mysore. So a number of these security guarantees, let's put it very loosely for now, a number of these security guarantees, which were sorts of military alliances, were being offered by the British to protect one princely ruler against the invasions from other princely rulers. So if you keep this much in mind, and if you see what is happening currently in India as well, over the past 1.5 years with the coming of the new ruling regime, as well as in continuity with what had been going on under the previous Manmohan Singh regime, India has been strongly forging a very strong bilateral relationship, specifically with Japan as well as with the US, as a counter to the Chinese assertion, specifically in the South China Sea as well as elsewhere. So if you see that kind of an agreement, and if you see specifically the Leoma agreement, the logistical exchange agreement that has been recently finalized with US, and India-US putting a joint vision for the South China Sea, you see a certain amount of closeness. I'm not saying alliance, where one offers a security guarantee to the other. The only kind of alliances that exist today, India is not a part of any security alliance with any other country in the world. But this is as close India has been with respect to US in terms of military relations as well as economic relations. But at the same point of time, there are many other security alliances that exist in the world today also. For example, NATO. NATO is a classical example. And the security alliance also exists between US and Japan, in the sense that Japan is under the nuclear cover that US has assured to provide. And that is one of the reasons why Japan has not pursued nuclear weapons in spite of being struck by nuclear weapons itself. So, military alliances are often formed in many ways, and here military alliances were being formed in this particular context. But we'll come to it. But nonetheless, but I just wanted to give you some geographical sense and territorial sense of what was happening and who was pitted against whom at different points of time. That is why I drew this map. But if you come here back, as I told you, Aliwardi Khan died in 1756 and was replaced by Siraj ud-Daulah. With the death of Aliwardi Khan, there was a bit of succession dispute between Aliwardi Khan, between Siraj ud-Daulah, who was a descendant of Aliwardi Khan, Ghasiti Begum, who was the daughter of Aliwardi Khan, and Shaukat Jung. The names are not important. What you only need to know is that Siraj ud-Daulah was a young Nawab, almost in his early 20s, when he became the Nawab of Bengal. When you are young, you always think you can change the world. And so Siraj ud-Daulah also thought that he could bring all those who had been closely aligned to the power circles under his control once he came to power. Now, coming to power for Siraj ud-Daulah meant that he would either have to be controlled by the Jagat Seth bankers or would control the Jagat Seth bankers. Now, why do I say either being controlled or control the Jagat Seth bankers? Is because of the fact that whatever trading policies were being drafted at this point of time were to benefit both the Indian traders as well as the Western traders. Now, one of the common things that any business community wants is lowering down the taxes. So, apart from lowering down the taxes, giving more quotas to certain Western players. So for example, there were a number of European traders who were coming to Bengal at this point of time for establishing trade relations. It was the, there was the English also, there was the French also, there was the Dutch also, and there was the Portuguese also. So one of the critical matters in front of the Nawab at this point of time was whether to give equal opportunity to all European traders to establish trading links or to privilege traders from one country over the other. Now the Jagat Sets were closely in line to the English East India Company traders. The English East India Company at this point was a private company, and so the Jagat Sets found the terms of the English East India Company more favorable for doing trade and thus were more closely aligned to the English East India Company. And apart from these, there were other reasons also, ultimately because of which both the English East India Company as well as the Jagat Sets sought a closer alliance with each other to favor the trading interests of both the parties. However, the Nawab did not firstly like this kind of an interference in the day-to-day policy matters of the Europeans, that is of the English East India Company, and at the same point of time tried to ensure that the Jagat Sets were brought under control and did not reach deals with the English East India Company on a day-to-day basis. Now the English East India Company was given the first trading rights in India and specifically in Bengal in 1690 by Aurangzeb himself on the payment of a small denomination of some 15,000 rupees or so at that point of time. Later, the later Mughal rulers also kept granting extensions to the English East India Company for granting trading privileges. However, in return for this granting of trading privileges, the English East India Company was also supposed to pay a tax. And over a period of time, what the problem that arose at this point of time was the Anglo-French rivalry. We will see that in 1750s, one of the biggest problems, in fact from 1742 onwards itself, one of the biggest problems was not between the English and the Indians, but between the English and the French. And the English and the French, and let me put this in perspective, then only you will understand, that before World War I, one of the biggest wars that engulfed whole of Europe and affected different parts of the world itself was the Austrian Succession War and the Seven-Year Wars that were primarily fought 1750s onwards, 1742 onwards specifically, taken 1750 onwards between the English and the French. तो आप सबको पता है कि वर्ल्ड वॉर वन में फ्रेंच एक तरफ थे और जर्मन एक तरफ थे, एंड जस्ट लाइक द फ्रेंच एंड द जर्मन राइवलरी वॉज देयर बिटवीन वर्ल्ड ड्यूरिंग वर्ल्ड वॉर वन एंड लेटर ड्यूरिंग वर्ल्ड वॉर टू एज वेल, द इंग्लिश एंड द फ्रेंच राइवलरी वॉज देयर ड्यूरिंग द 1750s इन द ऑस्ट्रियन सक्सेशन वॉर एंड द सेवन ईयर्स वॉर. आई एम जस्ट पुटिंग इट क्योंकि हम अभी वर्ल्ड हिस्ट्री डिस्कस नहीं कर रहे, तो वी आर नॉट गेटिंग इट, बट नंदलेस in these 7 year wars and in these bitter wars between the English and the French, often what would happen is that the English and the French would fight wars not just in Europe but in India, in Philippines, in West Africa, in North America to control each other's colonies. Okay, for example, we will see later there were a number of Anglo-Carnatic wars. In the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, the wars were primarily being fought between the English forces and the French forces. So there was a bitter rivalry to control colonies and to control trade between the English and the French throughout the world. India also was one of the major flashpoints, and a consequence of this was that there was a bitter competition between the English and the French of who would get more trading privileges and trading rights with respect to India. So the English were not just concerned of the fact that whether they would get favorable trading terms with the Indians, but also of the fact that they wanted to outcompete or outdo the French while establishing trade relations with India. Now, so because of this also, the English started cultivating the Jagat Sets bankers and were more successful. Now the French were no saints. The argument is not that the French were saints and the English were devils. The argument is that both were competing European powers who were seeking to extend their markets and their trading privileges. The English were able to build an alliance with Jagat Seth, and when Jagat Seth's bankers realized that the Nawab was not obliging them with the kind of decisions that would have been favorable for them, and the Nawab also started realizing that the English are trying to deliberately disobey his orders, that is when the Nawab said, enough is enough, I'm the one who's in charge here and I'll make decisions. And with this, he decided to throw the English out of Bengal and disregard all the trading privileges previously extended to them and throw the English out of Bengal. Now, the English at this point of time had started doing a number of things while disobeying the orders of the young Siraj ud-Daula. Some of them were, for example, he would give refuge to the fugitives from the Nawab's court. So those who were dissidents from the Nawab's court, the English would often give refuge to them within their own forts, and this obviously did not go down well with the Nawab. So the Nawab declared an open attack on the English forts. So the English East India Company then had an important trading base in Calcutta. So the Nawab went over and took over Calcutta. At the same point of time, the English had an important fort in Qasim Bazar, very close to Calcutta. Again, the Nawab went there, militarily took over the fort and completely disarmed the English fort in Qasim Bazar itself. So this was the initial attack by Siraj ud-Daula, which was very successful, and the English East India Company was forced on a retreat because of the attack of Siraj. However, after this attack, an initial attack by Siraj ud-Daula, the English East India Company, led by Robert Clive, started moving from down southwards towards Calcutta. And when Robert Clive reached Plassey, that is where the war was supposed to happen. But Siraj ud-Daula's military general at this point of time was Mir Jafar, and Mir Jafar, in collaboration with Jagat Seth bankers, refused to obey the orders of Siraj ud-Daula. The result was, when Siraj ud-Daula gave the call for war, almost more than half of his army did not turn up or did not pick up the arms against the British, and the result was a coup where Siraj ud-Daula was deposed without actually having a war in the first place. So the battle of 1857, the battle of 1757 was merely a skirmish, not a full-blown battle. And with this, Siraj ud-Daula was deposed and Mir Jafar was made the next Nawab of Bengal. And this was the Battle of Plassey. But however, and what is important from the main's point of view is the significance of the Battle of Plassey. Okay. And what was the impact of this battle? And we'll talk about it. But this is what broadly happened in the battle for now. Now, one of the other things, was that, as I told you, the intense court factionalism destabilized the administration of Bengal, and the advantage was taken by the British East India Company, which acquired a foothold in Bengali politics through the Plassey conspiracy and ended the rule of Siraj ud-Daula. Now, if you look at the Battle of Plassey, as I told you, that Aurangzeb granted the British the rights initially for duty-free trade in Bengal for a sum of rupees 3,000. Later, Farrukh Siyar extended these trading privileges even further and even gave the right to the British to collect rent from 38 villages around Calcutta and even to use the royal mint. However, now this is not important, but this tells you about what is the kind of stature of Murshid Quli. Because Murshid Quli refused to obey the orders of Farrukh Siyar. Murshid Quli said, I am not going to grant these revenue collecting rights or the right to use the royal mint. So that was the kind of extent of control that Farrukh Siyar, that Murshid Quli had at that point of time. In 1750s, as I told you, that the British were apprehensive of the French presence and victories in South India, and the English private trade suffered heavily in the 1750s. Now, this I haven't completely explained it to you for now, but one of the things that we'll see later, that while the important trading presence of the English was established in Bengal, the eminent trading or the important trading position of the French was established in areas around Pondicherry. Okay, and that is where they established their major trading port in the first place. So the French were establishing themselves as a preeminent South Indian power, whereas the English were establishing themselves as a preeminent power in Bengal. So the English were apprehensive of the French presence and of the competition by the French. And one of the things that the English also were consciously afraid of, that Siraj ud-Daulah was trying to cultivate the French as well as later the Dutch and the Portuguese as a counterbalance to the English, or was thinking of doing that. And this also made the English more apprehensive at this point of time. And the result was that the English suspected French competition in collusion with the other Asian merchants in the region. So this one of the factors, apart from other factors, was also the factor of Anglo-French rivalry. That was the reason for the Battle of Plassey. Now, if you start thinking of the reasons for the Battle of Plassey, one of the things that it becomes clear is, firstly, is with the death of Aliwardi Khan, the matter precipitates because of the internal succession dispute itself. Right, because whenever there is a succession dispute and a new Nawab comes to power who does not enjoy the kind of stature that the previous rulers enjoyed, then that gives an opportunity for external players to intervene. So one of the reasons was the bitter internal succession disputes after the death of Aliwardi Khan. The other reason was the Anglo-French rivalry at this point of time. And also, this all is happening primarily because the centralized Mughal rule no longer existed. So these were some of the major reasons. Now in 1755, the English began renovating their fortifications in Calcutta without the Nawab's permission, and in utter defiance of its authority, began to offer protection to the fugitives from his court. So initially, when they were given trading rights, they were refused, or they were not given the right to establish their armed presence or fortify, meaning using their forts and putting arms in them to fortify the fort. So they were refused the right to fortify their forts or to use armed protection in their forts. But later they started doing this secretly. When the Nawab came to know of this, he interpreted this as a defiance of his authority, and also of the fact that the English East India Company was also trying to offer refuge to those who were hiding or were running away from the Nawab's court at this point of time. So the Siraj ud-Daulah became Nawab. He took over the British factory in Qasim Bazar, and this was followed by Siraj's attack on Calcutta and its capture on the 20th June 1756. So the initial phase of Siraj's aggression against the English East India Company was successful. However, when there was a full-blown reaction by the English, the Nawab could not, effectively tackle this threat. Not because of primarily any military weakness or such, because of the conspiracy itself, which deposed the Nawab without any significant challenge being brought to the fore. So, once the crisis was precipitated, Robert Clive arrived with a strong army from Madras, and a dissatisfied faction within Nawab's court, consisting of merchant bankers, powerful bankers like Jagat Seth, sided with the British. The result was that the Battle of Plassey was merely a skirmish, not a full-blown battle, and the military commander of Siraj, that is Mir Jafar, effected a coup d'etat with the support of the Jagat Seth brothers. So, if we look at this much, and I'll take your doubts and I'll repeat anything if you would want me to. But before we do that, one of the important things that has to be understood is that the Battle of Plassey was to play a very, very crucial role, or in many ways marked the arrival of British in India. In the sense that, yes, the English East India Company had trading privileges since 1690 itself. But why do we say that it is the Battle of Plassey which marked the entry of, or which significantly marks the entry of English East India Company in India, is because of the fact that this is the first military conquest and a significant military conquest that the British achieved against one of the most prosperous provinces of the Mughal state. Now, ek cheez hoti hai, and this is something that you'll always see even when we'll take our discussions further, is that we start interpreting, and whenever we see at the past, we start seeing the future in the past, in the sense that a number of you would be thinking at this point of time, see, in the Battle of Plassey, when the Nawab lost to the English, from this point it became clear that the English will now rule India. So often we start thinking in those dimensions. Okay, this was the war after which the game turned, and now the English, it was almost clear that the English would rule India. No, I'm not saying any of this. I'm not saying that with the Battle of Plassey it became clear that the English will become the next pan-Indian empire, or that the English will rule India. I'm not saying so. Similarly, for example, you'll see, when we'll see later, that I'll say that in this particular year there was Maudlin Minto reforms, or this reforms or that reforms, and a communalization of Indian politics could be seen from here. So students directly reach the conclusion, in this year it became clear that partition was inevitable. No, history doesn't work that way. Not everything is inevitable just because it started somewhere. You know, you could always look back at history and say that is when it all started, right? So I'm not making the point here that in 1757 it became clear that English will become the next preeminent power in India. Far from it. We do not even know what could have been the outcome of an actual 1757 war if it would have taken place. In the sense that it could be argued that there was a possibility that maybe Siraj Udaula could have defeated the English, provided his army would have stayed with him, right? So let's not conclude that with this war it became clear. But the significance of the Battle of Plassey was, you know, in many ways, the significance of the Battle of Plassey was, firstly, this was the first major outside power from outside the region which was a threat and which established itself as a credible threat to other regional players. And given the fact that the Nawab of Bengal was a direct descendant of the Mughals, a decisive defeat for the Nawab of Bengal meant a tremendous blow to the prestige of the Mughal Empire. At the same point of time, it raised the prestige of the English East India Company as an important player. Now when the war was happening, and after the result of the war, obviously the Marathas, the Nizam and the Mysore state all are looking at how the English had become important in Bengal. And in many ways, this made English an important player to reckon with in the region. So that is something that is one of the consequences, and we'll discuss in detail, but that is one of the consequences. Another consequence of the Battle of, okay, so we'll see the consequences first. The first thing is, the Plassey battle paved the way for British rule in Bengal and India. In the sense, I'm saying paved the way for British rule in Bengal and India, not to mean, and this should not be interpreted as that with this it became clear that the British will rule Bengal and eventually India, but this was their first opening into Bengal. And the war boosted the British prestige and in a single stroke raised them to the status of a major contender for the Indian Empire. When I'm saying contender for the Indian Empire, it needs to be understood that not just the English were the contenders for the Indian Empire, but the Marathas were also a contender. The Hyderabad state was not to the extent that the Marathas were, but the Marathas and the Mysore state definitely were important contenders at this point of time. And the English also became important. At this point of time, it was nowhere clear whether the English would become the next pan-Indian empire or not. So, an important consequence of the Battle of Plassey, and this is something that we'll come to, and this is called as the Plassey plunder, is that the revenues that the British received after fighting the war, after fighting this war, the British received a number, a good amount of war indemnity. Or the British, after this battle, got roughly 22.5 million rupees from the Bengali state as a war indemnity. Or a war indemnity basically means a kind of penalty that is imposed on the other party by the winning party. So the English imposed almost a penalty of roughly 22.5 million rupees at this point of time, which was a huge amount of money. And the English East India Company at this point of time was a private company. It was not the British, under the British government's direct control. So the revenue boost that the English East India Company received after the Battle of Plassey was used to build a strong army. Till the Battle of Plassey, they did not have a very strong and formidable army. But with the kind of revenues that they generated after this war, they used it to build a stronger army and to finance their other wars with other major powers in the region. And we'll come to it, but this is also one of the important significance of one of the most important significance of the wars, that the war and the indemnity received by the British because of their success in the war enabled them or strengthened them financially to fight further wars with Marathas, with the French, with the Hyderabad state, and thus strengthened it financially. So that is also one of the important significance of the Battle of Plassey, in the sense that the Plassey plunder, almost £2,75,000, when you convert it will come out to be roughly the same amount. An immediate war indemnity was to be paid to the British, and immediately they had to pay £2,75,000, and that was a huge amount. £2,75,000 was a huge amount almost 200 years ago. And after this, they over 3 years had to pay 22.5 million rupees. And Mir Jafar, in recognition of his important role played in upstaging Siraj Ud-Daula, was made the next Nawab after Siraj Ud-Daula. However, Mir Jafar soon realized that the kind of influence that the Jagat Seth had left him with little actual authority over the governing matters of the state. And moreover, he had to pay such a huge tax, almost a tax to the British. And realizing this, Mir Jafar realized that he could not pay such kind of a tax or could carry out his governance in an effective manner. The result was that the British later replaced Mir Jafar with Mir Qasim, because Mir Jafar could not satisfy the demands imposed upon the Bengali state by the British. So the result was Mir Jafar was replaced by Mir Jafar was replaced by Mir Qasim. Another point here, which is not that important, but because you people know a bit of economy, it should not be that difficult to understand. See, they raised this kind of money here with this kind of war penalties that they were able to impose on the British, on the Bengali state. The British East India Company raised a huge amount of revenue. With this, they bought gold. Okay, and with this gold, they used to buy Indian goods and sell them in other markets. So now they became important traders both on the Indian side and on the outside side. And at the same point of time, they did not need to bring in their finances from outside to carry on their trading activities any further. Rather, they used the gold from within India and exported to other countries, making more gold and then exporting all the profit, on taking all the profit back to Europe. अगर ये चीज़ नहीं समझ में आई तो कोई बात भी नहीं है, it's not that relevant to understand. But just for completeness sake, I'm mentioning this, that prior to Plassey, the trade with Bengal was financed from bullion or gold imported from Europe. But after Plassey, the bullion was exported from Bengal to China and other parts of India for trade purposes. So basically, what is to understand is that before this war, when trade used to happen, the gold used to come in India. But after this war, to finance their trade, they used to take in gold from India, and then finally, all the profits that were made went back to Europe. So that's a very simplified and crude version of explaining. It is not that important. This last point that I explained to you is not that important from exam point of view also, but explains how, trade was happening at this point of time and how the British financed their trade activity. Okay, I'll answer your question. So what he is asking is that this decision of carrying out the trade in the manner and of imposing the war penalties, was it a decision taken by the English East India Company or by the British Parliament or by the British government? No, the British government did not have any direct role in this matter till the war. So, with respect to the role of the army, one of the things that we'll see later is that for a long period of time, the English East India Company did not bring in the British army. Because bringing in the British army would have meant paying a dividend to the British government. Basically, and let's put it this way, if the state will protect the economic interests of any private entity, because the English East India Company was a private entity, then the English East India Company also would pay back to the government in the form of taxes. So for a long period of time, the English East India Company did not pay taxes to the British government. Once they brought in the British army, they had to pay taxes and in the form of an annual dividend. And that we'll come to later when we'll talk about the British government in general. Okay? But for now, it is important to understand that the English East India Company in its initial stages was not something that was under the direct control of the British government. Okay? And we'll come to it later. It is only very slowly after 1780s onwards that the British government starts to slowly and slowly start exercising control over the East India Company. We'll come to it. Okay? I just want to finish one more portion and then I'll take up doubts and repeat also if you want me to repeat anything. Is it clear? Everything clear till here? Is there a doubt? Okay. Now, one of the things that has to be understood also at this point of time is that Bengal was not the only power. And once Mir Jafar was deposed, then Mir Qasim was made the next Nawab in Bengal. But even Mir Qasim soon realized that with such a kind of heavy financial penalty and stringent control, and then stringent control that the Jagat Seth bankers and others tried to exert upon him, he did not have much autonomy left with him. And so Mir Jafar, Mir Qasim also was not very satisfied with the scheme of things, where he was under the strict control of the Jagat Seth brothers and the English East India Company. So Mir Qasim was also looking for an opportunity to, maybe if possible, overthrow the British and the British influence in the region itself. And for this, he sought the help of Awadh and the centralized Mughal ruler. And for this, so Shuja-ud-Dawla, not Siraj-ud-Dawla, Shuja-ud-Dawla, who was the Nawab of Awadh, along with Mir Qasim, along with Shah Alam II. Shah Alam II, the name is not that important. even if you remember in this place you write the Mughal emperor at that point of time, it is okay. Okay, so all three of them formed an alliance and they decided to take down the British in a combined manner, and this is what led to the Battle of Buxar in 1764. Now in this battle, one thing that should come to your mind is Mir Qasim had his personal grudges against the British. Then why was Shuja-ud-Dawla ready to fight the war? I mean, there is no question of any brotherly love here, or you know, just because we all are descendants of the Mughals and the English is an outsider power, you know, so we are all Indians, and so there's no such feeling here. Okay, but why is it that Shuja-ud-Dawla was ready to form an alliance with Mir Qasim at this point of time? So what he is pointing out is partly right, that on the one hand, the Shuja-ud-Dawla realized that to the extent that Bengal was under threat today, and if the ruler of Bengal would come under British control, then it was likely that the next challenge to Awadh would come from Bengal. At the same point of time, thus all three of them, this was one of the reasons why Shuja-ud-Dawla entered into an alliance with Mir Qasim at this point of time. So in this Battle of Buxar, which was to happen in 1764, between 1757 to 1764, roughly 7 years have passed. In this period, in this intervening period, strengthened by the finances that the English East India Company received after the Plassey plunder, the English invested heavily in terms of increasing their military presence in the region. And by the time of Battle of Buxar, they had strengthened their military presence to the extent that the alliance of Shuja-ud-Dawla, Mir Qasim and Shah Alam II was unable to defeat the British in the Battle of Buxar. And thus, in the Battle of Buxar, one of the reasons for the defeat, apart from the strong military presence of British, was also the fact that there was no unified military leadership, because there were three important leaders, and in terms of military leadership, there was no clear cut unified strategy and planning at this point of time, in contrast to the British, who were under the leadership of Clive and later other military generals at this point of time. So in 1763, Shah Alam II, Shuja-ud-Dawla, the Nawab of Awadh and Mir Qasim planned to form a grand alliance to fight against the British. And in 1764, the Battle of Buxar happened. And in this battle, an 18th century Indian army with its segmentary social organization was in a serious disadvantage against a technically efficient English army with a unified command. In terms of technical efficiency, also one of the things that should be known is that by this time, the English had mastered the Enfield rifle. And the English had brought in their Enfield rifle by this point of time, not just in India, but in West Africa also at this point of time. And with the fact that they had a rifle and the Indians were still fighting with swords and spikes, also gave them a sort of a technical and military edge over the Indians at this point of time. So after the battle happened the Treaty of Allahabad, and in this treaty, firstly, Shah Alam II was said that you continue to be a Mughal emperor anyways, the Mughal emperor today is not of much use. So Shah Alam II was not touched because he represented the symbolic authority of the Mughal empire, and the British even now were not in a mood to directly challenge, or were not having the intention of directly subjugating the centralized Mughal rule, but were more interested in strengthening their trading presence in the region. And this was reflected in the Treaty of Allahabad, in the sense that what the British were interested at this point of time was strengthening their trading privileges and strengthening their finances. And for this, after the Treaty of Allahabad, they got the revenue collecting rights for Bengal, Bihar, and Orissa. So they got the right to collect revenue from the whole of Bengal, Bihar, and Orissa, as we understand today. So this was a huge boost to their revenues. At the same point of time, the British also, after the Treaty of Allahabad, got a right to control the day-to-day affairs. I'm saying control, not completely take over, but the right to control the day-to-day affairs of the Bengali state, in the sense that a British resident was placed in the court of the Nawab of Bengal after this time, which was there at Murshidabad, not at Calcutta, but was there at Murshidabad. And in the court of the Nawab, a British resident would be posted, and all major decisions would be taken with the information of the British resident. I'm not saying with the consent, but with the information, in the sense that often the British official would be involved in the framing of policies of the Bengali state after this point of time. Also, not just Bengal had to pay the price for this, but Awadh also had to be, was also made to pay a price for this, in the sense that Shuja-ud-Daulah firstly paid 5 million rupees to the company because of imposing a war on the British. And secondly, the British also got trading rights in Awadh. At the same point of time, a British resident would be posted in Awadh itself. So you see that in the battle of, so one, whenever the question comes, the question is likely going to come on discuss the battle of discuss whether it is on the significance of the Battle of Plassey or the likely impact of the Battle of Plassey. Then even when you write about the Battle of Plassey, you don't have to write only about the Battle of Plassey, but also about the Battle of Buxar, because they both are logically interconnected to each other. So even, and I'm saying this again, even if the question is on Battle of Plassey, you write about Battle of Plassey as well as Battle of Buxar. Okay? You don't need to write only about one of the wars, okay? Because one is logically interrelated to the other. And so one of this consequence of both the Battle of Plassey and the Battle of Buxar was that this strengthened British position. This made the British an important contender, an important regional player in the region. It strengthened them financially. And thus, what one sees is that with this, what one sees is that this was to play an important role in giving a British an important toehold in the region itself. So if you see in terms of the causes of the Battle of Plassey, the first thing which could be termed as one of the causes for the Battle of Plassey was the activities of Siraj-ud-Daulah himself, who was trying to bring the Jagat Seth under his control, and at the same point of time was trying to discipline the English East India Company. So the assertive Nawab, who threatened the privileges of the East India Company, was also one of the precipitating causes for the Battle of Plassey itself. The second important cause was the Anglo-French rivalry, and how the English suspected that the French of having a closer relation with Siraj-ud-Daulah, and thus were apprehensive of the activities of Siraj-ud-Daulah, and thus tried to bring the Nawabi court under its own control by forming an alliance with the Jagat Seth bankers. Just a second. I'm just having a bit of cold today. Just I just told him to get me a coffee without sugar. So, okay, everybody heard it, okay. So when we talk of the Battle of Plassey, the second major cause was the Anglo-French rivalry. The third important cause was, in many ways, the defiance of the Nawab's authority and the defection of the merchant bankers who felt threatened by the young Nawab. Why I'm writing almost similar things and breaking down them into 4 points is essentially because if you have to write an answer on the causes and the significance of the war, you should have some three or four things clubbed in causes and some three or four things clubbed in terms of the impact of the war. So if you talk about the impact or the significance of the Battle of Plassey and the Battle of Buxar, the first important thing was that the battle raised British prestige and made them an important contender to the British to become the next pan-Indian empire. At the same point of time, it boosted the reserves of the British East India Company because of the Plassey plunder. And we talked about how they had to pay 2,75,000 initially, then another 25 million rupees, and then again, Awadh also had to pay a huge financial cost for it. Now, the numbers are not very important. You don't need to be, you know, ki itna hi tha, but I've just mentioned them. But huge war indemnities had to be paid. Even that is okay if you write in the answer. And these finances enabled the British East India Company to build a strong military presence in the region, enabled by the strengthening of its finances. And finally, the Treaty of Allahabad granted them important revenue collecting rights from the whole of Bengal, Bihar, and Odisha. Now, any doubts still here? You didn't. How did it impact? So I'll repeat that. So that is one question that if, and I'll explain that again, the impact of the Anglo-French rivalry, okay? And how did it impact the war itself? Anything else? Anything else? How come there's nothing, anything else? Either you people are understanding everything or you're not understanding anything. Or you're just enjoying the show. हाँ, कुछ चल रहा है, कहानी में कुछ हो रहा है, ट्विस्ट आ रहा है था थोड़ी देर में. या नो नो ही इज नॉट अनअवेयर. सो मीर कासिम वॉज नॉट अनअवेयर ऑफ द. सो वट इज आस्किंग इज वट मीर कासिम अनअवेयर ऑफ द राइवलरी बिटवीन द इंग्लिश एंड द फ्रेंच. नो, मीर कासिम वॉज नॉट अनअवेयर ऑफ द राइवलरी. In fact, there were many times, I'm not getting into that detail because it's not relevant from the examination point of view. There were many times when these regional players would also try to cultivate one European player against the other. Why they had not taken the help of French? One of the answer will come when we'll see the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, in the sense that the French and the English were pitted against each other there, and you would see their major involvement in that particular region. Because one of the things that has to be understood that the French were already occupied in a very significant way in South India. They did play some role even in Bengal, but not to the kind of extent that they played in South India. So we'll see that. But not, so that is why we're not discussing the French role there. But to give, just because you raised this question, even today, if you see in foreign policy, especially in South Asia, one of the important things that you see often is, you know, smaller regional players, or in the sense of smaller countries within South Asia, often try to pit either India and China against each other in their effort to extract more benefits or privileges from one of the countries. For example, Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has given access to the Hambantota port to China at very favorable terms. At the same point of time, it continues to attract a significant amount of attention as well as material help from India as well, in terms of loans, in terms of soft loans, as well as in terms of reconstruction and aid services in northern Sri Lanka. So Myanmar also almost, so this is, for example, Nepal. Nepal always
for whatever maybe its domestic concerns, often tries to pit and tries to say that India is the hegemon who's trying to restrict the options and the autonomy of Nepal as a state, and would often look to China for certain interference, or one could say certain amount of aid at certain point of time. So you could see this kind of a thing even at a number of places within China, for example, the latest example of Philippines, and the Philippine president saying bad things to Obama and quoting the Chinese on the other. So this kind of balancing external players is something that wasn't absent at that point of the time itself, and we'll see that more in the case of South India, because that was the area where the French had a important presence. Okay, that's the reason. Yeah, I'll come to your question. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, the idea of, so what he's asking is, we all keep studying about divide and rule and the role of British and how they're trying to play divide and rule, and but that has not come till under discussion till whatever you have discussed there, is because the British themselves have not fully arrived yet. Okay, so there's no question of the British playing divide and rule at this point of time. So whatever we talk of the British divide and rule policy is once the British establish their administrative presence here. I didn't say the administrative power. I just said revenue collecting rights. Revenue collecting rights does not mean administrative presence in the sense that they do not. Yeah, so. No, what I'm basically trying to say is that wait for the British to establish their presence, and then you will see. At this point of time, the 17th century India, the whole idea of divide rule is one where you're dividing the local community and then trying to rule them and all those things, that will come much later. And that is the reason why I've not discussed that. Once I'll discuss, then you'll understand later why it is of no relevance at this point of time, the whole idea of divide and rule itself. Because the British were not ruling India at this point of time. In one, I'm putting that very simply as of now. See, so with respect to the British Army, what she's asking is a valid question. What was the composition of the British Army? So the composition of the British Army for in India was predominantly the English in the top positions, and in the most important positions, it was the English who were there. In terms of foot soldiers, they recruited locally as well as the Europeans. Okay? So that was there. And overall, we'll see later the composition of the army over and above the rank of Subedar within the British Indian Army later. Once the British established their full presence in the British Indian Army, over and above the rank of Subedar, all the positions were reserved for the whites. Below that position, the Indians were recruited. Okay? Divide and rule. Everybody should forget divide and rule for now. When divide and rule comes, then we'll talk about divide and rule, and I'll explain why that concept does not apply here. That I'll explain. Dekhiye. See, with respect to divide and rule, I haven't even defined what does divide and rule policy mean. If, right, so it could be subjected to many interpretations, just like the term secularism is today, right? What is divide and rule policy? You could have your own definition, he could have his own, I could have my own, right? So it could be subjected ki bhai, if you are dividing regions, then that is also divide and rule. If you're dividing Hindus and Muslims, then that is also divide and rule. If you're dividing upper caste and lower caste, that is also divide and rule. What is divide and rule? Everything is divide and rule. So that would be such an expansive definition that everything could be clubbed in there, right? So that is something that is definitional inaccuracy. If there is a conceptual inaccuracy, then you could say ki sab kuch to ho hi raha hai, right? So that is why I'm not getting into that now. Now, to your, his question is on the Anglo-French rivalry. Anything else?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So you are asking, was it the decline of Mughals which enabled the rise of British? Or the rise of the successor states which enabled the rise of British, right? See, देखिए बात वही है. आप जो बात कहना चाह रहे हैं कि इट इज द डिक्लाइन ऑफ द मुगल सेंट्रलाइज मुगल रूलर्स और द सेंट्रलाइज मुगल स्टेट विच अलाउड द स्मॉलर रीजनल प्लेयर्स टू बिकम इंपॉर्टेंट प्लेयर इन द पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ द रीजन इंक्लूडिंग द ब्रिटिश. ओके दैट्स देयर. आई एम नॉट मेकिंग सच अ क्लेम हेयर एट दिस पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम दैट दिस इनेबल्ड द राइज ऑफ दैट एंड ऑल दैट. सॉरी. एनी अदर डाउट स्टिल देयर? ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी केम इन टू इंडिया वेयर देवर ग्रांटेड परमानेंट ट्रेडिंग राइट्स औरंगजेब ऑनवर्ड्स. ओके दे हैड सम ट्रेडिंग प्रेजेंस हेयर एंड देयर बिफोर औरंगजेब ऑल्सो बट दे गॉट फॉर्मल ट्रेडिंग राइट्स विद औरंगजेब इटसेल्फ. Okay, so what she's asking is, what was the structure of Indian exports after the Battle of Plassey? We will see that later when we see in a couple of classes from now that roughly up till 1800 or so, they were exporting finished products, and after more so after 1800, they were exporting raw materials. So that was it. But we'll see that in greater detail at a later point of time. Any other doubts? So one of the questions is, during the Battle of Plassey and the Battle of Buxar, why the Marathas did not challenge the Bengal province? Okay, so one of the students is asking the question that during the Battle of Plassey and Buxar, why did the Marathas did not use this opportunity to tackle Bengal? One of the understandings is that, as I told you, that they had already reached a certain amount of agreement in 1751 with the Bengali state of not, you know, had reached a treaty where they had settled the matter of Chowth for this region. One of the reasons was that they had already reached a settlement in terms of the revenue arrangement with the Bengali state, and on another side, by the Battle of Buxar, there was something that had dramatically changed for the Marathas that I have not discussed till now, and I'll discuss later, and that is the battle of the third battle of Panipat. It was the third battle of Panipat which had weakened the Marathas so much financially as well as in terms of their administrative capacity that they were not even in a position in 1761 to actually after 1761 to challenge other players at this point of time. So these were the two major reasons, okay, broadly. But we'll come to the significance of the Battle of Panipat later when I'll discuss Marathas separately. So now finally, I'll explain it a bit in brief again in terms of what was the significance of the French as well as the English and on the Bengal question. See, the significance of the Anglo-French rivalry was there with respect to Bengal, even with respect to Hyderabad state. Okay? In both these places, we'll see, because the next in line is something that we'll discuss, is Hyderabad itself. So both the places in Bengal and Hyderabad, we'll see this fact that whether it was Bengal or it was Hyderabad, in the state of Hyderabad, we'll see firstly that the French were the dominant powers because they were closer to the ruling elites, and they were successfully for a long period of time were able to keep the French were able to keep the English out of their territorial control in the region. However, and in the Bengal region, as we have already seen, that the English had established their preeminence. Now, the when and we will see that in 1750s itself, okay, 1750s itself, we will see that the French had started becoming powerful in South India, and it is 1757 and then 1764 by the time by which English became the preeminent power here.
So, because the French had become the preeminent power before in South India, before the English had become the preeminent power in Bengal, the English was always suspicious that the French will upstage them in England, in Bengal as well. So they, and because of this, they always suspected that Siraj-ud-Daulah would cultivate and will establish a strong relations with the French. And just like the French had been successful installing favorable regimes in Hyderabad, they will install regimes favorable to the French in Bengal as well, at the disadvantage of the English. That was the major reason of the Anglo-French rivalry. Now, the Anglo-French rivalry also was not just limited to India, but the Anglo-French rivalry, for example, was there in United States as well. For example, in United States, the French territory of Louisiana was later taken over by the British when these wars were going on. So all of these were important, you know. So even in North America or in India or in Philippines, there was this constant battle between the French and the English in terms of controlling the territories, because at that point of time, the French and the English were the major European powers. So that was there. अच्छा ये भी सुन लिया गया ओके इज दिस मच क्लियर टू एवरीवन ओके वाज इट the tax that they were giving to the I do not have any knowledge of it, in the sense that I personally do not know anything accurate about this what you're asking, but it is unlikely, in the sense that the if the English were controlling the revenues, they were unlikely to devolve such revenue collecting powers to the Marathas. Now, till now I have talked to you about Bengal. The next, yeah. So his question is, and after this I'll take the questions once I finish discussions for the next things that I take up, is why the English, French, Portuguese, Dutch all were interested in India. Was it because of economic reasons or also because of certain other factors? I do not know certain other factors. I just know of the economic factors. Primarily because whatever may be other motives apart from this, the primary motive definitely was economics. A search for markets, a search for revenue, and a search for strong trading surplus is what guided colonial economic policies or colonial policies themselves, not just in India but throughout the world. So the English and French were at loggerheads in North America also, and that is why it is said that colonialism is nothing but a market strategy. The whole idea of colonialism itself is to secure markets for one's own goods. And आप लोगों ने कॉलोनियलिज्म, न्यू कॉलोनियलिज्म ये सब कुछ पढ़ा है? इकोनॉमिक्स में नहीं पढ़ा है अभी. गुड, इकोनॉमिक्स हैज बीन डन राइट? हैज इट बीन? इट इज बीइंग टॉट राइट नाउ. इट विल बी टॉट. ओके ओके मे बी दैट वाज अनदर बैच. सो okay, in the sense that, okay, we'll come to it then later, but we say in many ways that one of the principal drivers of colonialism is economic interest. It may be, there may be others, but that is the main interest. Okay, now let's come here. Now, one of the things that becomes visible, and you will see this in some time, is that though I have already talked to you about Bengal and the British presence in Bengal, an equally important flashpoint was Hyderabad, or what is also often known as the Carnatic region, broadly as the Carnatic region itself. Okay, and one of the things that we will see is that in 1764, roughly by 1764, in Bengal, the British had established their military presence, and roughly also by the same time, the British had overthrown the French in the region of Hyderabad and had established their presence here as well. So 1764 was roughly 64-63 was roughly the time by which they had become an important power to reckon with, not just in the Bengali state but also in the Hyderabad state. And how it happened, we'll see that after. And then what we will see is the power in this region was the Marathas. Now Marathas was a threat to both Bengal and Hyderabad, and apart from them, one could say there was Mysore. So once the British had taken down Bengal and roughly around the same time Hyderabad, the next state that they took down was Mysore. And finally, when Marathas were surrounded from all three sides by the British, that is when they took down the Marathas in 1815. Mysore was taken down in 1799. By 1815, thus what you find is that by and large, the Britishers, in a span of some 50 years of continuous war fighting, had established them as an important or possibly the only contender to the throne of India after 1815. Okay, so this is roughly, you know, a kind of way in which the British proceeded in this region. So we've already talked about Bengal. Now we'll talk about Hyderabad, then we'll talk about Mysore, and then lastly we'll talk about Marathas. Once we've completed this much, broadly our discussion up till 1857 is, or up till the arrival of British, is over. Okay, we'll talk about other things also, but broadly this is the order at which I wish to proceed from here on. When we talk about Hyderabad, we'll talk about the Carnatic Wars. To tackle Hyderabad, the wars that were fought were known as the Carnatic Wars. The other name for the Carnatic Wars were also the Anglo-French Wars. Okay. The next, the wars that were fought in Mysore were known as the Anglo-Mysore Wars. And the wars that were fought in with the Marathas were known as the Anglo-Maratha Wars. So if we keep this much in mind, let's first move to the Hyderabad state. When we look at Hyderabad, the only important thing from the mains point of view with respect to Hyderabad is the significance of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Okay, that is the only thing that is important to know. And as I told you before, the Nizamul Mulk, who had played a critical role in assassinating the Sayyid brothers and becoming the Wazir himself under Muhammad Shah, later went on to become the autonomous governor of Hyderabad state. And the Nizam permanently settled in Hyderabad and became the governor and became more or less autonomous, and he was the Nizam of Hyderabad till he was alive in 1748. It is only with his death in 1748 that what happened in Hyderabad was broadly similar to what happened in Bengal, and later we'll see what happened in Marathas also is a bitter succession dispute. Every time a major important of these regional leaders or rulers died, there was a succession dispute, and this succession dispute gave an opportunity to external players to influence the domestic politics of the region. Case in point, again, one of the where do you see this current great political flux because of the death of a strong leader? I'm not saying a great leader. Tamil Nadu, Andhra, after YSR Reddy, one could say yes, but that's true. But currently, what I will be referring to is the case of the death of Jayalalitha and the power tussle and the succession disputes within. Yeah, Sasikala and others. So, okay, aap logo ke, just because we talked about Jayalalitha, so I'm not talking about something, anything else. I'm only sticking to what is relevant from the examination point of view. There was a question in your paper too this year, in your mains examination, the 2016 mains examination, discussed Amartya Sen's views on education and healthcare and primary healthcare and its relevance. Okay, and why I'm bringing this up here is so that was a mains question in your paper too, though primarily Amartya Sen is an economist, but the question came in paper too. Why I'm discussing this here is because in the last major book that Amartya Sen has written, was written in 2012, and the name of the book was An Uncertain Glory, India and Its Contradictions. In this book, he's again, Amartya Sen is a developmental economist. He keeps writing about the fact of how primary education and primary healthcare is very essential for the development of human capabilities. And one of the shining examples of this is Tamil Nadu. Okay, so in the sense that we all know about Kerala, we all keep reading about Kerala in terms of literacy, in terms of healthcare. Kerala is way ahead in terms of family planning. Every developmental indicator, Kerala is much ahead of the rest of the Indian states. And that has been the historical legacy of Kerala. But Tamil Nadu, over the past 30 years or past 35 years, has successfully or has been one of the fastest moving states on the HDI index, of on the Human Development Index. Tamil Nadu has been one of the best performers over the past 30 years and has almost reached a similar position of that of Kerala. And that is because in Kerala, in Tamil Nadu today, you have almost universal primary health center, operational primary health centers, where you have 24 hours deliveries which are conducted at the rural center level. You have a more or less universal primary education system. Tamil Nadu also was the first state in the country which came up with the whole idea of midday meal schemes. Much before Jayalalitha, much before the government of India thought of the midday meal schemes, it was the Tamil Nadu state which had introduced a midday meal scheme in their state. Yeah, activity based learning is also there, but I was just in terms of universalizing. And also, one of the things which is strongly associated with Jayalalitha was the Amma canteens. And the Amma canteens have been considered as a very important landmark and initiative in terms of fighting urban poverty as well as in tackling malnutrition. And so, and this was something that was very strongly referred to by Amartya Sen also in his last book itself. He's written almost two chapters on this. So that is why that came in your exam also. Now, why Amartya Sen came in your exam is because he is the only person to reckon with in terms of developmental economics, not just in India, but throughout the world. So, nonetheless, let's keep all of this out and come back here, right? Now, now one of the things that has to be understood here is, we talked about of how the Bengali administrative structure under Murshid Kuli underwent a certain amount of change. In Bengal, Murshid Kuli, we had talked about, I had told you that how did Murshid Kuli cultivate a large number of or a few number of large zamindars at the expense of a large number of few zamindars. So he consolidated the revenue collecting system in Bengal. However, when we see in Hyderabad, I am not going to pay more emphasis on what was the administrative structure in Hyderabad, primarily because there were not anything of significance from our examination point of view. Only one thing that you could keep in your mind was that in the Hyderabad state, under Nizam-ul-Mulk, he made only certain modifications to the existing system of Mughal administration. For example, he made the Jagirdari system hereditary, and now it became the Zamindari system. So I told you that the Jagirdari system was not hereditary, right, under Mughal rule, that the Jagirs were transferable. But here he made the Jagirdari system hereditary, and now it became the Zamindari system. More than this, I have though mentioned certain things, but unless you don't really need to remember anything except the fact that the Jagirs became hereditary and the Mansabdari system retained few of its original features. The main thing that we need to understand is why did the Anglo-Carnatic Wars happen? And what was the Anglo-French rivalry about? What was the significance of the Carnatic Wars? Or what was the significance of the Anglo-French rivalry? That is the only thing that we need to focus upon. Once I've discussed with you the Anglo-French rivalry, and if at all the question comes on the significance of the Anglo-French rivalry for the structure of 18th century India, you will have to write about Anglo-French rivalry and the Carnatic Wars in Hyderabad, but also about how the Anglo-French rivalry impacted the Bengali state. We had talked about how the Anglo-French rivalry played an important role in the launch of the Battle of Plassey. So that also has to come in your answer if you are writing about the significance of Anglo-French rivalry, not just about Hyderabad. क्योंकि अभी मैं आपको पढ़ाऊंगा तो फिर उसके बाद आपको बस ये लगेगा कि एंग्लो फ्रेंच राइवलरी वॉज ओनली अबाउट द हैदराबाद स्टेट और द कर्नाटक रीजन, बट इट वॉज ऑल्सो अबाउट द बंगाल स्टेट. तो अगर आंसर स्पेसिफिकली द क्वेश्चन इज स्पेसिफिकली ऑन द सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ द एंग्लो फ्रेंच राइवलरी, यू हैव टू राइट बोथ अबाउट हैदराबाद एंड अबाउट बंगाल. सो if we look at the Carnatic Wars, I would want you to firstly see a map which is a related map, but not completely related also, but it is partially related to this. Forget the heading, though it is about the Anglo-Mysore Wars, I just want you to see the map. Okay, the reason why I want you to see the map is because it helps you get, just see this first one for now. Okay, if you see the first map, you see the area in green, that is Mysore state. Forget the year, forget everything, you just see the map. This is roughly the boundary of the Mysore state. You see the area outlined in blue. Can everybody see? Is it visible? Okay. So the area under blue is the Nizam's territory. Adjacent to is the Peshwa's territory or under Marathas. Above also is the Peshwa's territory only, but that is where the Peshwa's territories are. And the area in red here was something that eventually came under British control later. But for now, you need to understand that this is the geographical area which was known as the Northern Sarkars. Okay. Also, the area that was known as the Carnatic area was this area, in the sense that there was no strict definition of Carnatic. So we often, when we talk about Carnatic music, we predominantly refer to Tamil Nadu as a state, but Carnatic then was mostly as a region. So even Tamil Nadu and areas extending out of Tamil Nadu, even in Hyderabad and Karnataka, they all came under the what was called as the Carnatic region. So even this area was broadly what was the Carnatic region. Now, something that you need to remember here is, in case of Nizam, the Nizam of Hyderabad was autonomous. Now, under the Nizam's indirect control was also the Nawab of Karnataka. Karnataka was also area which came under the Nawab of Hyderabad, but indirectly, not under his direct control. And there was also a Nawab of Carnatic region who was more or less autonomous of the Nawab of Hyderabad. So though the Nawab of Carnatic or the boundaries of Carnatic or of the Nawab of Carnatic are not shown here, but as I was roughly referring to, that was what was understood as the Carnatic region. So if you just keep this much of the map based understanding in mind as of now, the important thing to note here is that when we look at the causes for the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, one of the first causes was for the Anglo-Carnatic Wars that started after the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk was the fact that the death of a strong ruler and the bitter succession disputes which started after it. That was one of the first major reasons for the war or for the starting of the war, and we'll come to it later. Okay, but that was one of the things that needs to be understood in mind. That one of the problems that Hyderabad was facing in 1748-1750 was the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk. The other problem that Hyderabad was facing at this point of time was the constant Maratha threat. I told you that before, almost by 1750s, the Marathas had become the preeminent power, and the Marathas were a threat even to Bengal and even to Hyderabad. Okay, in the sense that after the Aurangzeb's death in 1707, followed by the weakening of the Hyderabad's control after the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk in 1748, the Maratha chiefs regularly invaded Hyderabad and the rest of South India, collecting Chauth. Chauth would basically be 1/4 of the tax of the whole region. And all these factors led to politically unsettled conditions and administrative disorganization. So on the inside, the Hyderabad state was dealing with succession disputes. On the outside, it was dealing with a constant Maratha threat. Now, if you keep this in mind and the succession disputes, one of the things that starts happening after this is that with the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk, the Nizam of or the Nawab of Carnatic actually started exerting more and more autonomy and became more autonomous after the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk. Okay, and why I'm emphasizing the Nawab of Carnatic so much, because the Nawab of Carnatic was the first one that the British approached for help when the French threatened the British in the region. We'll come to it. But the French were the first ones who took down the Nawab of Carnatic, because the Nawab of Carnatic was closing up with the English at this point of time. We'll come to it. But just remember, there's another Carnatic, the Nawab of Carnatic, who was also to play an important role in the war. But what was this bitter succession dispute that I am talking to you about again and again? Let me just take you to that bitter succession dispute first. And this is the succession dispute. Carnatic and Hyderabad both were important regions in this, and Carnatic was under the indirect control of Hyderabad. This I have told you. When you look at Hyderabad state after the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk, the succession disputes was between the Nizam's son and Nizam's grandson. That is between Nasir Jung and Muzaffar Jung. The names are not that important. Okay. But even if you want to remember, you just remember the name of Muzaffar Jung. Now the English supported Nasir Jung and the French supported Muzaffar Jung. And the result of this succession dispute was that the Muzaffar Jung ultimately emerged successful. And with Muzaffar Jung emerging successful, he once became the Nawab, he granted trading privileges to the French in the Hyderabad state. Similarly, in the Carnatic region, Chand Sahib was an important treasurer of the Nawab of Carnatic, who was Nawab Anwaruddin. The name of Anwaruddin is not important. What is the only thing that you can know is that with the French help, Chand Sahib assassinated Nawab Anwaruddin and himself became the Nawab. So French had supported two important contenders to the throne, both in Hyderabad and in Karnataka, and both of them emerged successful. The result was that the French got trading rights in both the region and became the important trading player in South India. So the name of the battle is not important, but basically if you are interested, that is, I've just given it, that in the Battle of Ambur, Dupleix, who was the French military general at this point of time, sealed a secret deal with Chand Sahib and Muzaffar Jung. Ultimately, Nawab Anwaruddin, who was the reigning Nawab of Karnataka, was killed, and the son of Nawab Anwaruddin actually fled at this point of time. Later, we'll see that the English would later support Nasir Jung in Hyderabad, and the son of Nawab Anwaruddin, that is Muhammad Ali, in Karnataka. Again, I'm saying the names are not that important. I've just given it because if you ask me ki who was who, so that is why I've given those names. Only thing that you will write in your answers is that in the bitter succession disputes after the death of Nizamul Mulk, the French were able to establish their firm position in South India by aiding the rise of Muzaffar Jung in Hyderabad and Chand Sahib in the Carnatic region. The result was that substantial territorial concessions were granted to the French in the region, with the result that in the form of northern sarkars were given as a jagir to the French. So you remember what I showed you in the map, northern sarkars? Sorry. So that is the region, the coastal region of Andhra Pradesh was broadly what was known as the northern sarkars. That was given as a jagir to the French in recognition for their help to Muzaffar Jung as an important player who aided the rise of Muzaffar Jung. And also areas in and around Pondicherry were handed over to the complete control of the French, and that is why Pondicherry has a strong, even today, has a number of structures of French descent in the region. Also, the French not just got territorial concessions in northern Jagir, but a French resident would always be stationed at the court of the Hyderabad's Nawab and would play a critical role in the day-to-day decision making of the Hyderabadi state. So in many ways, it was not the English, I'm just telling you, in many ways it was the French who were the ones who perfected this art of interfering in succession disputes, because these succession disputes were happening in 1749-50. The succession dispute in Bengal happened in 1757-56, right? So the French were the ones who first devised this formula. The English were to learn from the French and were to apply this in other areas as well, not just here. So that is what broadly was the succession dispute about, and how the French gained trading privileges. It is, you know, we always keep hearing, even in today's context, that often number of domestic political leaders, not just in India but throughout the world, keep accusing other external powers of interfering. Some of the times, and a number of, I'm saying that some of these times, these accusations are not without merit. There are instances where there is enough reason to believe that external players do play a crucial role whenever power, or whenever there is a succession change likely to happen. For example, currently in United States, Russia has been accused, and because of which Obama, the outgoing Obama administration, has imposed more financial sanctions against Russia on the possibility of having interfered in the domestic politics by resorting to cyber attacks in the domestic political campaigning between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. So it isn't without a reason, because if you see the timings of leaks, often were at times done in a manner that would favor one candidate over the other.
So that is why it isn't always without merits, you know, that you'll find people trying to take advantage of who gets to be the next. And even in South Asia also there are plenty of examples. For example, I'm just putting there the last example and we can move forward. In Bangladesh, one of the constant tussles between Sheikh Hasina and Khalida Zia is that Khalida Zia has often accused Sheikh Hasina of being closer to New Delhi, in the sense that of taking a more pro-India stand and often of selling out to the Indian government, and has often tried and has often portrayed India as an external player who tries to domestically meddle with the domestic affairs of the Bangladeshi state. Whether true or false is another matter. By and large, it is true, yes, it is true that India does share a closer proximity to Bangladesh when Sheikh Hasina is in power rather than when Khalida Zia is. But there is no reason to believe that India has interfered in any of the elections that has happened in Bangladesh and have been happening intermittently there. Similarly, in Sri Lanka is another matter. But okay, let's come back here. Any doubts still here? Is it clear? Okay. So, if we keep this much in mind, what is to be understood is that after 1740 there were bitter succession disputes, and which gave the opportunity to European trading companies to directly interfere in Indian politics. Now, I told you that in 1690 is when the English established the trading presence, right? And 1660 onwards, and in many ways, the French East India Company came to India first and established a trading presence here. But they chose Pondicherry, and they took Pondicherry as their main important trading center in the region. Now, I'll explain to you what was the Anglo-Carnatic Wars all about, and what was the main reason for the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Till now, I have been talking to you about the succession disputes as an important reason, and also the decline of a strong centralized ruler in the Hyderabadi state, that is the death of the Nawab. But apart from this, there is a bigger reason, and in fact, in many ways, the most important reason for the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, and that was the English and French rivalry, and that was with respect to the Austrian succession dispute. We'll see what was that. So you can take your 5-minute break, your customary 5-minute break, and then we'll resume. Okay. So, with respect to the Carnatic Wars, one of the things to understand here is what was the reason for this Anglo-French rivalry? But this is something that would be predominantly even not covered in world history, because this is a period of world history which is not important from your mains point of view also. But so as to have an understanding of what this issue was all about, broadly, if you see the European map, what you'll find is that in 1760s, or rather in 1750s, one of the central questions was the Austrian succession dispute, in the sense that in Austria, in Austria there was an empire which was by the name of the Habsburg Empire. In the Habsburg Empire, which was the ruling empire in Austria at that point of time, was often at loggerheads with another. I'm just briefly explaining so that you should have some sense of what this is going to be about. That Austria was often at loggerheads with Prussia. Prussia then was what we understand today as a part of Germany. Okay, so yeah,
Russia and Austria were often at loggerheads. In one of these wars, when there was a succession dispute in Austria in 1742, okay, when there was a succession dispute in Austria in 1742, Prussia took away Sicily, an important part of Austrian Empire at that point of time, and that is from when the dispute between Prussia and Austria started. Eventually, this snowballed into a major conflict between all major European powers, and the result was that the French and the British were often at loggerheads here, with the French supporting and the British were in support of Austria. Because of this, there was a huge succession dispute and a battle, and eventually on the question of territorial concessions between Austria and Prussia, or Prussia, over specifically the control of Sicily, there was a battle between French and Austria. This started somewhere in 1742, and ultimately, finally, after the 1757 to 1763, what was also known as the Seven-Year War, this matter was finally settled between French and Britain, who were the major European powers and rivals at that point of time, eventually settling the matter. And so often these wars between France and Britain were fought in all the countries or in all the continents where they had their colonies, whether it was America or North America, whether it was West Africa, whether it was India, or whether it was Philippines. So this was something that was happening at this point of time. So India also was one of the major places or flashpoints of the wars, or of these wars as a result of these succession disputes following the Habsburg Empire. Now, while the English and the French were competing with each other, Hyderabad also, which was an important state at this point of time in this region, was looking to cultivate the English or the French. You know, so they were obviously the succession dispute which we saw, where English and French are often at loggerheads with each other. But at the same point of time, the Hyderabadi state was also looking for having some sort of an alliance with any of the European powers against other regional players like the Marathas. So in the ideal world, for example, what the Hyderabad state would have wanted would have been maybe use another external player against the regional players to its own advantage. So one of the motives why the Hyderabadi state was okay seeking an external alliance with an external power was also because of the constant Maratha threat and the Maratha invasion that were happening because of the peak of the Maratha glory, and because of the fact that the Marathas was strongest in terms of the military strength during this period of time. So that was also one of the major reasons. Now, the first Carnatic War, okay, the first Carnatic War that happened was from 1742 to 1748. Now this war was some 6 years long war, and the dates are not that important. Okay, what you need to know is that this is the first war that happened before the succession dispute in Hyderabad. The succession dispute in Hyderabad happened in 1750, but the first Anglo-Carnatic War happened in 1740s itself. Because this war was happening not because of the succession dispute in India, but because of the succession dispute in the Habsburg Empire. So when their war started in Europe, they started fighting in India to take control of each other's territorial territories in India. And because of this, the French attacked the English trading positions in South India. The result was that the English rushed to the Nawab of Carnatic for help. The Nawab of Carnatic intervened on behalf of the British, but the Nawab himself was defeated of Carnatic at the hands of French, and दस इन द जो अल्टीमेटली इस पूरी कहानी में से आपको याद रखने वाली बात है दैट इन द फर्स्ट कार्नाटिक वॉर द फ्रेंच वर द वंस हु इमर्ज्ड विक्टोरियस ओके एट द एक्सपेंस ऑफ द इंग्लिश एंड द लोकल नेटिव रूलर्स ओके सो इन द फर्स्ट एंग्लो कार्नाटिक वॉर इट वॉज द फ्रेंच हु इमर्ज्ड विक्टोरियस हुआ क्या था दैट आई हैव टोल्ड ओनली फॉर द सेक ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग You will not write this anywhere in the exam because you will not have that kind of space to write any of this in the exam. But now, even this is not that important to remember in terms of the name of the treaty. But though by 1748, the French had defeated the English in South India in the first war. In the treaty that happened in 1748 by the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, they reversed the position. Whatever defeat or whatever territories that had been taken over by French of the British in India were given back to the British in return for the English returning Louisiana back to French in North America. So basically, this was a kind of a ceasefire. After 6 years of war, they reached a kind of a ceasefire where the territories of one grabbed by the other were returned back. And so, territorial concessions were granted to the English by the French in India in exchange for the similar concessions that were granted to the French by the English in North America. That's all that you should be knowing. That's more than enough, frankly. Because this is not a question on world history or not even this is a question on modern world history that is a part of your syllabus. That this is more than enough to know. So the English possessions in India were returned while the French got back their North American possessions at the return of the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, whatever you want to call it. I'm not good in French. So anyways. So if you see, I had already explained to you what was the succession dispute within the Carnatic about. Right, and ultimately the succession disputes within the Carnatic started in 1749 or 1750 after the first Anglo-Carnatic war, and the result was that the French were able to successfully install ruling elites closer to them. The result was the French were granted territorial concessions such as a northern jagir being granted, northern sarkars being granted as a jagir to the French, and thus as a result of intervening in this succession disputes, the French became the preeminent power to reckon with in South India. However, the Second Carnatic War thus was what was actually the war that was dealing with these succession disputes, because the English were supporting the opposite and the French were supporting the opposite. Now, in the Second Carnatic War, when the Second Carnatic War began, initially the French installed the rulers favorable to them in both Carnatic and Hyderabad. But later, during the later stages of the Second Carnatic War, the tables turned and the English became successful in the sense that while Chand Sahib had killed Nawab Anwaruddin, Chand Sahib himself was assassinated by the English, and they installed the son of Nawab Anwaruddin, Muhammad Ali, as the Nawab of Carnatic. And similarly, in Hyderabad, the similar thing that happened in Hyderabad, where Muzaffar Jung was defeated by Nasir Jung with the help of the British. So initially, the French were successful, but by the end of the war, the British emerged successful in terms of installing rulers closer to them in both Hyderabad and in Carnatic. So what you need to just know is that in the first Anglo-Carnatic war, it was the French who were successful. In the second, it was ultimately the English who were successful. But just like the French had returned all the possessions that they had gained after the first Anglo-Carnatic war, the English returned all the possessions they had gained after the Second Anglo-Carnatic War. And in 1754, there was a treaty between the English and the French, and the French agreed to the English demand for the recall of General Dupleix from India. Dupleix was the French general at that point of time, and in return, the English allowed the French to retain their control over the Carnatic, the Northern Sarkars, and the controlling influence over the Hyderabad court. So you see again a kind of a ceasefire even after the Second War itself, that the French were allowed to keep all the possessions that they had before the Second War. This was all again a part of the wider game that was being played out throughout other continents, because of which they were reaching certain truths at certain points of time. However, and this was the Second War. However, in the Third War, and this was the Third Anglo-Carnatic War that was to happen, from 1757 to 1763, and this was what was termed as the Seven-Year War. This was the final, or the third, or the last, or the final Anglo-Carnatic War. In this war also, ultimately the English emerged victorious, and the French were reduced to a very small position in and around Pondicherry at this point of time. आपको बस इतना याद रखना है कि पहली वॉर में फ्रेंच जीते थे, द सेकंड एंड थर्ड द इंग्लिश इमर्ज्ड विक्टोरियस. इन द थर्ड एंग्लो कार्नाटिक वॉर देयर वाज एन इंपॉर्टेंट बैटल जिसका नाम आपको याद रखना है, एंड दैट वाज द बैटल ऑफ वॉन्डीवॉश. इन द थर्ड एंग्लो कार्नाटिक वॉर एन इंपॉर्टेंट बैटल हैपेंड, दैट वाज द बैटल ऑफ WANDIWASH, the Battle of Wandiwash. In this battle of 1760, or the Battle of Wandiwash, after this battle, in this battle, ultimately the French were decisively defeated by the English. And in 1763, a treaty was signed, and this name of the treaty is also important, the Treaty of Paris. This treaty was signed in Paris, after which again finally there was a decisive truce between the English and the French, and in this decisive truce again they reached a final position that the French will be allowed to continue doing trade and continue the trading positions in South India. But by now the French had decided themselves to leave India, because of the reason, because they realized that now they were no longer, they could no longer be the dominant players in this region because of the existing political climate, where the British had successfully established themselves as a important player in South India as well. So basically what was happening was that by this time the British had become, because of the successive defeats that the French had suffered and the success that the British received in installing rulers favorable to them in the court of Hyderabad as well as Karnataka, eventually the French realized that even if they continued their trade here, they could never become the, they would not be able to become the major trading powers in the region, because the ruling elites were closer to the British, and the British had successfully and decisively defeated them over two wars. The result was this, that after the Treaty of Paris, though they were allowed to continue trade in India according to the terms of the treaty, the French completely or slowly over a period of time withdrew from India and stopped looking at India as a major destination for its presence at this point of time. So the Seven-Year War between English and the French was responsible in many ways for the Third Carnatic War, and the French lost all their positions successfully. In South India, Pondicherry was their major port which they held, and this they lost. And in the region around Bengal, Chandernagor was also an important position that they held, even this they lost to the British. So whether it was in Bengal or it was in Hyderabad or basically the region around Pondicherry, they lost all their important positions in South India as well as in the region around Bengal. On the western side, the Mahe port also on the western side in the region was to play an important role for the French presence, and even this was lost in this third war. So what basically I'm trying to explain is, you don't need to remember the names. All I'm trying to say is that whatever were the important French ports, they were decisively lost to the British in this third war. And after this, the French decided to withdraw from India. Now, this was also, so in the third Anglo-Carnatic War, there was the Battle of Wandiwash, and in this war the French was decisively defeated as Pondicherry itself was seized, and the Mahe port along the Malabar coast, along the coastline of Kerala, was taken over by the British, and thus the French were left without a toehold in India. Though according to the Treaty of Paris, they were allowed to continue their trade in India by the British, but by now the French realized that they could not be the preeminent power in the region and thus decided to withdraw from the region. Now, one thing that I have not told you till now is, while the English East India Company was a private trading company, the French East India Company was a government-owned trading company. So, and when these wars were going on, especially the Second Anglo-Carnatic War and the Third Anglo-Carnatic War, when these wars were going on in this region, to tackle the French East India Company, which was supported by the French army, the British also sent their army. And the army of the British government also came to the rescue of the British East India Company. The result was that it strengthened the long-term presence of the army in India, in the sense that the British army came to the rescue of the English East India Company to be primarily of use against the French East India Company. But over a period of time, this brought in crown troops in India and were later to be used by the English East India Company to defend their positions against other regional players as well, in the sense that over a period of time, the one thing that is important to know why I am bringing this point of crown troops or the British troops coming in into India is that they decidedly tilted the balance in the favor of the English East India Company against the other regional players after this time, because the British army was coming to the rescue of the English East India Company, and the British army definitely was technologically more superior to any of the regional players in India at this point of time. As long as it was the English East India Company, a private trading company, against regional players, the regional players had a strong chance. But if it was to be pitted against the British Empire itself, then things were definitely not going to be directly favorable for the regional players. And so, one of the important consequences we'll see of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars was that they brought in crown troops in India and ultimately tilted the favor in the long term in the favor of the English East India Company vis-a-vis the other regional players. Now, as I told you sometime before, that once the British army came into India, that after this point of time, the demand in the British Parliament also grew that the English East India Company should start paying certain dividend to the British government, because the government is using the taxpayer money and using the government's army to protect the interests of the British East India Company. But more of it will come to later. I'm just putting out that pointer here. So that is what happened at this point of time. So when we talk about the consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, it is important to know that one of the first and the major consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic War was the French defeat. And in many ways, the Anglo-Carnatic War removed the greatest or the biggest European rivals to the British presence in India. And the defeat of the, and one could, you know, and the fact that the French were defeated at the hands of English meant that a major counter force to the British, which were the French, who could have been used later by other regional players to balance the British presence in their region, was now gone. For example, we'll see that Mysore under Tipu Sultan often looked to the French to establish closer trading relations with the French as a counter to British. But with their defeat in the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, the French were no longer the major rivals, and you know, the bigger issue, for example, for the English to deal with was not, was on the one side they had the regional players to deal with, but on the other side they had the French. Once the French threat was eliminated, the English could concentrate in a more free manners on the regional players in the region itself. So one of the consequences, so one of the long-term consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic War was that it eliminated the French threat to the British assets in India and allowed it to focus more upon the regional players itself. So that was one of the main consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic War, that the major European rivals to the British interests in India were eliminated after the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. The second was that, and this is also a very crucial important consequence, and this is something that we'll return to again later also, that, and this is the consequence that is of supreme importance, was that while with installing a favorable regime to the British state or to the British East India Company in Hyderabad, the Hyderabad state was forced by the British also, and partly the Hyderabad state also was motivated to enter into a military alliance with the British, and this was called as the subsidiary alliance. Now in detail we'll talk about subsidiary alliance when I talk to you about the Marathas, but in brief for understanding here, the subsidiary alliance was signed by the Hyderabadi state with the British, which offered a kind of a military guarantee to the British, which offered a kind of a military guarantee to Hyderabadi state against other regional players. So basically one of the terms of the agreement was that the Hyderabad state would pay an annual maintenance fee to the British army or to the English East India Company basically, and the English East India Company will deploy its armed forces to protect the Hyderabadi state from other regional players, namely the Marathas or the state of Mysore. Okay, so Marathas and Mysore, which was the significant regional threat to Hyderabad, would be kept at check because the English would offer assured military support to the Hyderabadi state in return for an annual revenue which is paid to the English East India Company. So this was the kind of alliance, a kind of a security guarantee, a kind of a military alliance that was forged between the British state and the, or between the English East India Company and the Hyderabad state. And this was done partly because of Hyderabad's concerns of being granted certain protection against the stronger Marathas and Mysore, but also at the same point of time it provided the British an opportunity to control the day-to-day affairs of the Hyderabad state without directly taking over the administration. Because one of the terms of the subsidiary alliance we'll see later was that whatever decision with respect to foreign policy or external relations with any other regional power were to be taken by Hyderabad could be taken only with the consent of the English East India Company. And even in terms of ensuring that no other regional player interferes with the Hyderabad state or any state with which the British signed a subsidiary alliance, the another term of the subsidiary alliance was that no other European except the British would either be employed by these regional states or any sort of a relationship with any other European power apart from British would not be established. So in one way, the subsidiary alliance system on the one side was attractive to the regional players because it offered them a sort of a military guarantee against other regional threats, but at the same point of time it compromised the autonomy of these princely states because no key foreign policy decisions could be taken without the consent of the British. Another recent example of this, for example, is India's relations with which country?
No. Yeah.
Bhutan. In the sense that Indian foreign policy and the bilateral relations between India and Bhutan have always been, and the relations that Bhutan establishes with any other country have often been very sensitive of India's concerns. In the sense that Bhutan is the only country in South Asia which does not have a permanent diplomatic relations with China. So, though explicitly on paper, obviously India has not prohibited Bhutan from establishing permanent diplomatic relations with any country, including with China, but the Bhutanese have often been very sensitive of India's opposition or India's perceived sense of concern with respect to the Chinese meddling affairs in Bhutan because of other reasons, also because of the territorial and the boundary issues with China. I don't have a map, but I'm just saying you can go back and see China, because Bhutan is where is very closer to the chicken's neck, right? Or that is exactly where the India's boundary is, almost very narrow. So near to that is something that's called as the Chamba Valley, okay, in the boundary of Bhutan with China. Okay, so Bhutan's certain amount of boundary with China is actually unsettled. Okay, so Bhutan, China has been pressing Bhutan for settling that boundary issue, but settling that boundary issue, Bhutan, India has categorically made it clear that it would not be very happy if Bhutan settles the boundary issue with China without keeping Indian concerns in mind. Because if you see that valley, the Chamba Valley, and where it's located, it's very close to the chicken's neck. So that will allow China to maintain its military presence very close to the Assam border and the West Bengal border. So that is why the Bhutanese have been very sensitive of Indian concerns, especially with respect to the Chinese or with respect to the control of the foreign policy, to the extent that India's concern of, you know, not establishing full-fledged diplomatic relations with China has often been taken into regard by Bhutanese very strictly. And actually, before the 2007, and this was also an important topic in your mains examination, I'm talking all of this because, for example, in international relations, South Asia and Indian foreign policy with respect to jab aap IR padhte hain newspaper mein bhi. So what is happening in Syria is 99% not going to be asked in your exam, primarily because India does not have any direct stakes in Syria. Okay? It may broadly, most probably be asked, for example, maybe in with respect to India's look west policy and the significance of regional stability, instability in West Asia for India's look west policy, but not a specific question on Syria. But everything specific in South Asia has been asked before, has been repeatedly asked in your mains examination. Tab aap apne IR ka agar syllabus dekhenge paper 2 mein, you will find there's a specific subtopic mentioned India and its relations with South Asian countries. So questions on India's relations with Nepal have been asked before. In the past 4 years only, you see the question papers. The issues of Nepal's federal structure and how it affects India-Nepal relations, a question that has been asked. With respect to Bangladesh and land boundary agreement, a question has been asked. Last to last year, there was a question on the China-Pakistan economic corridor, the Kashgar corridor, and its impact on India. Indian foreign policy. Before that, so one of the things, or for example, this year also in paper 1, geography, there was a question asked on the Indus Water Treaty. 3 years before also the same question was asked on the Indus Water Treaty. So South Asia is super, super important when you're looking at IR. So what is happening in every part of the world, in say Germany or in France, is not that important. But what is happening in South Asia is extremely important. And this is also why I'm bringing this is because before the Indo-Bhutan Friendship Treaty was revised, one of the explicit clauses in the Indo-Bhutan Friendship Treaty was that Bhutan would not establish friendly relations with any country which are likely to have an adverse effect on India. Okay, but that has been removed now, and Bhutan as a sovereign country is well within its right to establish diplomatic relations with any country. But that shows what is the kind of concern India has shown with respect to Bhutan. And lastly, to add some masala to the whole issue, it was in 2011, I think, that Bhutan and certain elements within the Bhutani administrative structure tried to court the Chinese. And at that point of time, India almost, that was time almost 3 weeks before the election, then India stopped supplying petrol and petroleum products to Bhutan. Bhutan being a landlocked country is predominantly dependent upon exports from India. The sudden arbitrary move of India of stopping petroleum exports led to a very high increase in the prices, and India was accused then by Bhutan of interfering in the domestic politics of Bhutan itself. So that is something. But Bhutan also, in many ways, last point, remains one of the strongest partners of India within South Asia. Bhutan ka 80% of the exports happens to India, and that export is hydropower or power generated to hydropower dams. India has played a crucial role in the construction of hydropower dams in Bhutan, to the extent that roughly 3000 megawatts of power is exported from Bhutan to India. 2 or 3 years ago, there was a huge 2 years ago I think there was a huge power crisis in Delhi during the summers. There was a snag, and because of which almost all of power of Delhi was gone, and this was happening repeatedly over 2 or 3 days. At that point of time, Delhi was importing power directly from Bhutan. Okay, so I mean, it's, and often India says that the kind of relation it shares with Bhutan is a model of regional cooperation that India would want to establish with every other country in South Asia. So that is there. Now come back here. And so if you come back here, one of the things that I've already told you is that the European rivals were eliminated with the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. The second thing was that the Hyderabad state became completely dependent on the British, and the Nizam in 1766 gave them northern Sarkars in return for military support against its own mighty neighbors, the Maratha and Mysore. This is also something that I've explained it to you. So Hyderabad was forced also in many ways into a subsidiary alliance, partly because of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars and partly because of its concerns of territorial threats from Mysore and Marathas. The third was, and this is also, I've explained it to you, that the Anglo-French rivalry brought in crown troops to India in significant numbers and considerably enhanced the military powers of the British vis-a-vis the other regional Indian states, and thus the balance of power now decisively began to tilt in the favor of British. So that is why I'm saying, and that is why I was saying, that just to see, for example, the Battle of Plassey or the Battle of Buxar as the war with which it became clear that the British will be the next preeminent powers in India is too early to conclude and is historically incorrect. Essentially because at the same point of time, if, for example, in South India, the French would have defeated the British, then the matter, or maybe the history also of the region, would have been very different, right? So that is why it's too early at this point of time to conclude that now it became clear that the English would rule India. Now, another thing was, another consequence of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, what the English had learnt their valuable lessons from the French, that they could also advance their economic and political interests by taking advantage of the military conflicts of Indian rulers, right? So, or the mutual conflicts of Indian rulers. So these were the four major consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Any doubts still here? No doubts. Anybody wants me to repeat anything? the backbenchers. Is it clear? Yeah, I mean, do you want me to repeat anything or anything? Is it fine? Yeah, third point. Yeah, no issues. Please feel free. See, that's why I politely keep saying 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. Kabhi to beech mein se koi nikal ke aayega. So, see, with respect to the crown troops, what is essentially I'm saying is because of the fact that the French East India Company was a government-owned company and which obviously brought the French army in. To tackle the French army, the British East India Company also was forced to appeal to the British government for help, and the result was the coming in of crown troops in India, which were initially meant to take care of the French aggression and to support the interests of the English East India Company, but later in the way was to pave the way for the long-term presence of the British troops in India, because of which also the English East India Company had to pay annual dividends at a later point of time to the British in India as well. The English East India Company had to pay annual dividends to the British Parliament or the British government for the presence of Crown troops. And once the Crown troops came in India, it became very clear that now the regional powers did not just have to deal with a private trading company that came from Britain, but had to deal with the British army itself. And so now the East India Company was rest assured that any kind of regional threat, you know, may come, but at least they could effectively defend themselves, if not defeat the regional players, right? So the balance of power vis-a-vis the other regional players was tilting in the favor of East India Company as an indirect consequence of the Anglo-Carnatic War. Is it clear now? Anything else? It's clear? Sahi hai? Okay. Now, in terms of the whole idea of, while we have talked about how the Anglo-Carnatic War impacted the structure of the regional powers in the region, one of the important things also that briefly needs to be discussed is why the French were defeated at the hands of the English. Now, the reasons for the French defeat in the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, there is no need to get into much detail, but some few factors need to be kept in mind. One of the important factors was that because we had talked about the fact that how the Battle of Plassey itself strengthened the position of the English East India Company substantially, right? So with the Battle of Plassey, by the time of Third Anglo-Carnatic War, the Battle of Plassey had already happened and the Plassey plunder had already happened. So the financial strength that the English East India Company received after the Battle of Plassey paved the way for financing their wars in the Third Anglo-Carnatic War, which was a 7-year decisive war. Or in the sense that while the English East India Company received a strong financial boost from the successes it registered in the Battle of Plassey, the French East India Company did not have an unlimited flow of money or finance to finance its war in the region. So financial difficulties affected the French East India Company's constant territorial expansion in the region, while on the other hand, the English East India Company was in a better financial position because of the Plassey plunder itself. So financial difficulties affected the military operations of the French forces was the first reason. Another reason was the kind of military leadership of the French in India. For example, Count de Lally was an important French military general, and the policy of Count de Lally, who was the French military general in India, really nearly alienated or caused a huge amount of dissatisfaction amongst a number of subordinate French officers in Pondicherry, thus affecting the efficiency of the force. Now, this is basically a question of military strategy in a way, right? So the leadership of the French military was relatively inferior For example, the po and so that is what is being referred to here, that the policies of Count de Lally cause a wide amount of discontent within the French army itself at this point of time, and that was also the reason for the defeat of the French. The third reason was the superiority of the English navy vis-a-vis the French navy and the ready supply of finances at their disposal after the Plassey plunder. The English navy was superior in terms of technological superiority. The English navy was superior as compared to the French navy, and that is also one of the reasons why the French were defeated at the hands of the English. So these were the three or four broad reasons why the French were defeated. That the English navy was superior to the French, that the French were not financially as strong, and the English had gained a huge amount of financial strength after the Plassey plunder. Please do not close your copies of books. We still have another 15 minutes to go. So 10 minutes more you can give me, right? That's why I'm saying 5:10 is 15 minutes from now, right? This, dekhiye, please, frankly, I'm telling this honestly also. If the students give an impression to the teacher that they're very interested in leaving, then the teacher also may not have much incentive to push forward. You should ideally, in the ideal world, frankly, and I'm putting this brutally and very honestly, I mean, this is the time when you should be pushing me. You know, and when I pose you a leading question, I mean, do you want a break or do you want me to, you know, stop now? You should say, no, sir, you can continue. In the sense, frankly, that if you push me, if you ask me more, I'll give you more. If you do not, then I'll also think, ki yaar, theek hai. And that is for your advantage, because ab to school ka 10th or 10th, 12th ka board to hai nahi ki 80 aa gaye ki 90 aa gaye. It is not a question of percentage, it's a question of percentile. So that way, and given the fact that you roughly have some 4 months, this year the exam is earlier, right? 4 or 5 months you have. And kal to waise bhi new year hai, to aap log to waise hi chill marenge, right? So in that interest, let's conclude the year with 10 minutes more, right? So if you look at what we have discussed till now, okay, we have another question, we'll take that. Okay, so one of the online students is asking that if I could please repeat the consequences of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, point 1 and 2. So again, if as I was telling you again and again, that once the French were eliminated, the Hyderabad state, for example, could no longer, or the ruling elites within the Hyderabad state could no longer think of a possibility also that the French could be used to counter the English in the region. This was a possibility that the Marathas explored very significantly. The Marathas, the Mysore state explored very, not Marathas, the Mysore state explored very significantly, because we will see that both Hyder Ali and then Tipu Sultan, both of them were looking at this point that if they could establish strong trading relations with the French, that could be used as a counter to the English. In a similar, so this possibility was eliminated after the Anglo-Carnatic Wars because of the fact that the, because of the essential fact that the French were completely eliminated. So no counterbalancing power to the English was available in this region. And this also gave an assurance to the English that they do not have a European power to deal with. They can purely focus on the regional players to expand their further economic interests. Second is that Hyderabad became completely dependent on the British. And we'll come to this point again. Because after the third Anglo-Carnatic War with the French eliminated, now Hyderabad was forced to sign a subsidiary alliance by the British on one side, because the British wanted to ensure that no another European threat happens in the future, by and because of which, and to ensure this, they signed, they forced Hyderabad to sign a subsidiary alliance which prohibited Hyderabad from establishing any diplomatic relations or military relations or economic relations with any other European power except the British. So that was one thing that the Britishers forced Hyderabad, and because of the fact, another term of the subsidiary alliance was that the subsidiary alliance offered the Hyderabadi state a military guarantee against the Marathas and the Mysore state. At the same point of time, we will see later that under the terms of subsidiary alliance, there was another provision which, according to which, while the British were, or the British armed forces were to be, were to protect the interests of the Hyderabadi state, but at the same point of time, under the subsidiary alliance system, the Hyderabadi state would no longer maintain its own army. Now, that was to happen because of two reasons. Firstly, the Hyderabadi state would have to pay a significant amount of revenue to the English East India Company to maintain the army. So, they were already spending too much revenue on maintaining an army, which the British would maintain, but use it to protect the interests of the Hyderabadi state. The net result would be that Hyderabad would pay to maintain an army, which would be a British army, with the assumption that the British would use this army to protect the interests of the Hyderabadi state. So the Hyderabadi state would spend money to maintain a British army rather than maintain its own army. The result was that the Hyderabadi state would completely become dependent on the support of the British by the subsidiary alliance system, especially against the regional player. So that was what is being sought in the second point. So now, finally, I've explained it to you, the causes for the French defeat also. Now, finally coming to the a summary of what we've discussed till now. With respect to the causes of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, we discussed that one of the causes for the Anglo-Carnatic War was the weakening of the Hyderabad state and the constant Maratha invasions. And this was responsible on the one side for the weakening of the Hyderabad state. The Maratha invasions were responsible for the weakening of the Maratha state. On the other side, the succession disputes were responsible for the weakening of the Hyderabad state. Maratha invasions were responsible for the weakening of Hyderabad state, and succession disputes were also responsible for the weakening of the Hyderabad state. And this obviously made it susceptible to external influences of whether the British or the French. The second was the succession disputes in the Carnatic region also, not just in Hyderabad state, but also in Carnatic region. We saw how the Nawab Anwaruddin was killed by Chand Sahib, right? Also, the Anglo-French rivalry, obviously, and the Austrian succession dispute was a critical reason for the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, because we saw that the first Anglo-Carnatic War happened before the succession dispute in Hyderabad from 1742 to 1748, while the succession dispute happened in Hyderabad after the death of Nizam-ul-Mulk in 1749-50. Okay. Also, the key battles that you need to remember with respect to the Anglo-Carnatic War is that the first battle, the English were defeated at the hands of French. In the second and third, the French were defeated at the hands of English. And the third, after the third battle of the third Carnatic War, was the Battle of Vondivosh that happened in 1760. It was a part of the third Carnatic War and the Treaty of Paris, after which the French withdrew from India. That's all you need to remember. And the impact, the French rival, the key European rivals were eliminated. The Nizam became completely dependent on the British for military support. And ultimately, this brought in crown troops in India, which was to strengthen the British vis-a-vis the other regional states. And also, the impact of the Anglo-Carnatic War was that it became a template for future British interventions in succession disputes of regional powers. So, I mean, dekhe, while I was talking yesterday, I told you about the whole importance of summarizing, you know, and making your own summary in terms of whatever we are discussing in the class. Now, I got a mail from one of the students yesterday that he was saying that if you look at the class, if you look at the vision handout material or the vision study material also that we give you, that, and if we use that and the class notes also to make a summary, it is very it will take too much time. Or it is because the vision handout material that you have is a very comprehensive material. Okay, it has almost everything. It's almost like a textbook only. Okay, but what I'm giving to you in the class slides is very concise. Okay, and very concise. So I want you to focus only in terms of reading, and this was also something the students were asking to me after the class yesterday. That dekhiye, aapko jo padhna hai, aapka first priority hona chahiye. Aap pehle class slides hi. Ye jo main aapko padha raha hu, isi ko aap ghar jaake padhiye. Then you pick up your spectrum and read the relevant portion. What I have taught to you in the class, that is what you read from spectrum. Okay, don't read spectrum in the order in which it is given in the book. If you have you people brought your spectrum today? Did you get your time? Everybody has a spectrum right now? No. How many don't have? Okay, so majority doesn't have. Please make sure that the next time you come for the class, you get your spectrum, because I'll help you mark. Okay, that these are the things that need to be. This is what you need to read. Yeah, in terms of summer, no, I personally don't feel. देखिए, after this, देखिए मैं आपको एक चीज और बता रहा हूँ बार बार. Just you do this much, the class notes and spectrum. इसके बाद there is NCERT also. There are many other things. Okay, why I'm saying you to stick to this only is because you will have limited time from here on, okay? And you will have many other subjects to refer to. If you want to read anything else, you're free to read after you do this, okay? Whether it is NCERT by Bipin Chandra or Shekhar Bandyopadhyay or what you're referring to, okay? So that is there. Any other doubts with respect to, and with respect to summarizing, if you use, okay, just 2 more minutes. Whenever you have a class with me, please be mentally prepared that your class will not get over at 5 o'clock. Okay? Other teachers may leave you at sharp 5. I'll leave you at least around 5:15. I want 15 minutes more every day. Okay? And I don't want to be under a constant pressure that 5 baj gaya. So you know, it's a kind of a relationship between you and me. You develop certain expectations out of me. I'll develop certain others. So my expectation is you give me 15 minutes more extra. Now, because otherwise I cannot talk about other things to you. Now, with respect to notes, with respect to summarizing, all I want you to do is, once you've read this and you've read the relevant portion from spectrum, you make a summary on the lines of how I've been giving you certain summaries. See, I've been giving you a summary of the causes of the war in 4 lines. Okay, this may not be the exact kind of summary you may want to make, given the fact you may not remember certain things subconsciously that I remember, and you would want to add more things in the summary itself. But this is a kind of a template. Agar aapke paas har cheez ke liye 4 ya 5 point hain, summarize. Ab summary ka matlab ye nahi hota hai ki aapne pura page likh diya, bhar diya. Summary mein to wo summary nahi hui na. Summary ka matlab is to summarize. But actually, making a good summary can happen only when you have read twice or thrice, because that will ensure that you're not writing everything in the summary. So आपको summarize करने की जल्दी अभी से नहीं होनी चाहिए, इसलिए मैंने कहा था अभी आप पढ़ते चलिए मेरे साथ जो जो क्लास में हो रहा है. Once you have completed the whole course with me and you have read everything again, जब आप एक बार मेरे साथ पढ़ लेंगे और एक बार जब आप खुद पढ़ेंगे इसके बाद, तो when you read the second time, then you make the summary. And you should be doing this for everything. At least, for example, I'd say for geography. Okay, I'm just saying this. For example, if you're doing geography, whatever you do in the class, okay, so whether you summarize or not, it's okay. At least aapke paas har cheez, ya aapke paas geography ke 50 diagrams ya 30 diagrams hone chahiye. Ki yaar agar soil pe kuch bhi aata hai, to this is my diagram. Is diagram se main revise kar lunga. Because geography is pictographic. A lot of geography is image based, right? So different subjects have different strategies of revision. To jo bachche karte hain after a year or 2 years, I'm telling you, now, if you see people and if you ask people how they've prepared, contrary to those who say, "Haan, hum to bas 3 ghante padhte the. Haan, hume to I just used to read the newspaper. To aise ho gaya." Apart from that, those super enlightened souls, for normal, average, middle class Indian, what you need to be doing is this: every subject demands a relatively different kind of a strategy. So for geography, you can rely on NCERT ka maps, ऑन दीज मैप्स, ऑन दीज डायग्राम्स, कि अगर आपको एल नीनो रिवाइज करना है तो आपके पास एल नीनो का एक डायग्राम है, उससे आपने एल नीनो रिवाइज कर लिया. अगर आपको सॉइल रिवाइज करना है तो आपके पास उसका एक डायग्राम है, उससे आपने सॉइल स्ट्रक्चर रिवाइज कर लिया. अगर आपको वेजिटेशन रिवाइज करना है तो उसका आपके पास एक डायग्राम है, राइट? सो दीज आर द डिफरेंट थिंग्स विच इफ यू डू फ्रॉम नाउ विल पे यू इन द लॉन्ग रन. ये सारा एनलाइटनमेंट प्री के बाद या अगले मेन्स, ये जो मेन्स आप लिखेंगे उसके बाद नहीं आना चाहिए, या अभी से आ जाना चाहिए ताकि आप अच्छे से अटेम्प्ट करें. बिकॉज आप में से कई लोगों के दिमाग में सबकॉन्शियसली ये चलता है कि भाई अभी प्री, अभी तो प्री पे फोकस करते हैं, प्री के बाद मेन्स पे चालू होंगे. दैट इज अ बैड थिंग टू डू. ओके, सो अभी से यू फोकस इन दैट डायरेक्शन. इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास विल स्टार्ट फ्रॉम मैसूर. ओके, एंड आई विल पिक अप पेस मोर फ्रॉम द नेक्स्ट क्लास.